Yeah. Good morning, guys. Today we are going to look at the topic of discussion is called bottom up parser. In the previous class itself, we have discussed what are all the types of bottom up parser. However, for the continuity of the bottom up parser discussion, let me start with this types of bottom up parser. Bottom up parser always stands for LR parser. L stands for left to right scanning. R stands for reverse of rightmost derivation. This we have discussed already. Then majorly bottom up parser is classified into two major classes. One is shift reduce parser, operator precedence parser. Operator precedence parser will work with ambiguity. Even though the given CFG is having ambiguity, it can work well. LR parser again categorized into four different types of parser. Simple LR, LR, LALR, canonical LR. All the parser uses stat data structure for the parsing action. In the previous class itself, we have seen top-down parser, the predominant data structure used for parsing action is stat. Similarly, here also stat is the predominant data structure we need to consider for all the parser. Here, the parser construction of operator precedence parser would be different, as well as the parser construction of all these parser would be different. Here, how the parser construction is happening. Let us forget about this operator precedence. This is only one parser, so we can discuss exclusively. The major classical items of parsers are these four. These four, how it works, let us quickly see. Then we walk through this. These four commonly starts with table. That table classified into action table and go to table. Now we are coming to different part of discussion. Normally I used to say table has only one section. In the case of bottom up parser, we used to see only one section. Now we are looking into it has two different section, that is action table and go to table. Table itself going to become two different part. Before the table, we need to generate canonical set computation. We need to, this is the primary job of very first step is canonical set computation. Nothing to worry. I'll be explaining. This is a problematic step. Very first step, we need to start with canonical set. Number two step is table construction. We need to construct the table. That table consists of action table and go to table. So these two parts we need to consider all the time whenever we are constructing a table. Number three, we must have parsing algorithm. Every parsing will have algorithm. There is no doubt about it. So we must have parsing algorithm or code or the routine. Then this is the number three step. When it becomes number four step, this is the third step. When it becomes fourth step is stack. This is the data structure. How to process the stack is the fourth point of discussion. These are all the four major steps involved. How it differs? We say SLR, LR, LALR, canonical LR. How it differs is, it differs, parsing algorithm will become same. Stack process also will become same. When it becomes different is canonical set and table construction, it becomes different. Each and every algorithm will differ with respect to canonical set computation and table construction. Within the table also, we have two part, action table, go to table. That means action and go to table, action table is meant for all the terminals. Go to table is meant for all the non-terminals. That's all. Nothing more we need to worry. So normally in the top-down parser, we used to consider only the terminals. Never we use non-terminals in the table, especially in the column. I mean to say column. Rows are constituted with non-terminal. Columns are constituted with terminal. That is what we have seen. But here the table construction will become different. All the rows will be constituted by the canonical states. Columns are going to be constituted by both terminal and non-terminal. That is how it differs. Nothing to worry right now. Just have the introductory glimpse to start solving the problem. While solving the problem, step-by-step guidance, you can able to understand what I mean to say. So here, canonical set, the table is consist of states, and states are going to become row. States are row. This you should understand. Then what would become column? This action table will have terminal, whereas this go-to will have non-terminal. That's all. Once this canonical sets are computed, construction of table will become much easier. That's it. With that introduction, let us move on. LR parser are used to parse larger class of context-free grammar. That is the beauty of LR parser. That is why we prefer LR parser. When we look at LL parser, the power of or the capability of LL parser can compute only smaller class of grammar. We have seen, check whether the given grammar is LL1 or not. Even a small grammar happened to become not a LL1 because multiple entry we have seen in a table construction. The moment multiple entry comes, the algorithm will become non-deterministic. Never we can approach computer with non-deterministic solution. So that is not at all LL1. Then how we can proceed further? That is why we are discussing top-down parser. To overcome that kind of difficulties, challenges, we need to move towards bottom-up parser. Whenever the table has multiple entry, those grammars cannot be solved by LL1. Those grammar could be solved only by LR. That is why we are moving to top-down parser. Now, in that context only, I am giving this point. LR parser can solve larger class of context-free grammar. That is the beauty of LR1. Normally, this technique is called LR of K parsing. What is the meaning of LR of K parsing? Let us see the expansion. L stands for left to right scanning of the input. We used to give input normally in the bottom up parser, top down parser, both parser. Input scanning will start from left to right. What is the meaning? You will be writing a coding now. Int a comma b comma c comma d semicolon. How your program has been verified? Your program is verified from left to right only. Then you will write a program. Scan of something input for ABC. Then you will do. C is equal to A plus B. Yeah, whatever the instruction you are writing in your programming approach, every part of your program, every statement of your program is being scanned from the direction left to right. So that is why LL parser, LR parser, both are having first L. That L stands for scanning your input from the left to right direction. That's it. Now what is R? R stands for rightmost derivation in reverse. This is called R. Otherwise, one more technical word is available. Canonical. This is just a simple terminology. Nothing to be afraid. The concept, once if you understand terminology, you may need to remember a while. That's it. So rightmost derivation, all of us knows. Always rightmost non-terminal will be replaced or substituted or derived. Always during the derivation process, we used to consider rightmost derivation. So that is what rightmost derivation. In reverse, what is it? Let us see during the problem solving. That is only one part you are going to look at different here. Nothing more. Now, next, K stands for number of input symbols. How many number of input symbols we are considering? If k becomes 0, number of input symbols, look ahead symbols. How many symbols we are going to consider? We are not going for looking ahead. If at all one symbol we are looking ahead. What is the meaning of looking ahead? For example, look off, look ahead. See, this is the important point. Look ahead, number of symbols. See, being a human, this entire sentence, if you start focusing on T, your eyes are scanning the other few characters also. That is what look ahead. For example, I am instructing you all to look at that capital T. Your eyes will not only look at T, subsequently few number of symbols, depending upon your capability, your visual memory capacity, you will be looking at. But every one of us, we as a human, tend to look at subsequent couple of characters. Even child also will look at. Similarly, in the compiler, what is the power we are giving? We are enabling the compiler. One symbol at a time we are about to read. How many symbols we are going to consider in our mind? Look ahead, further we are considering. That is termed as look ahead. If I ask you to focus on this T, your brain or your eyes naturally will look at least 2-3 characters. E-H-E-R, 2-3 characters. You imagine consciously. You practice this consciously. That is called look ahead. But how we are empowering that look ahead to the machine is the point of discussion here. So K stands for number of symbol look ahead. There are 4 widely used algorithms for LR parser. SLR, simple LR, then LR, LALR, look ahead LR, CLR, canonical LR. These are all the 4 parser. The order in which it is arranged shows the power of computation. When it comes, these 4 parser, canonical LR has more power of computation. Although it has more power of computation, there are a lot of drawbacks as well. So that is what we are going to discuss right now. SLR works on smallest class of grammar. Although it is bit powerful than LL, LR, a simple SLR, will work on only smaller set of context-free grammar. Very few grammar, it suits well. It works well for very few grammar. Few number of states. As I mentioned here, canonical set, table, states or row. Canonical set itself, state computation only. Now, it results with few number of states. Whenever number of states are lesser, table also will become smaller. State, we are going to draw one kind of finite automata. You all aware that what is finite automata or transition diagram. So that transition diagram is called canonical set, or that for the canonical set only we are going to draw transition diagram. That is the exact articulation. Subsequently, you imagine now, number of states are more, then table will become more, no? In the DFA construction, in the NFA to DFA, by that time itself you would have noticed. That is what we are trying to tell. Number of states are lesser, so that table is also smaller. It is simple and fast. Yes, of course it is simple and fast, but the power of computation is smaller. That is why we are moving to next parser. Finally, what is the message is, given the context of the programming construct or the particular CFG, if it is possible to simulate by SLR, we need to proceed. If not only, we need to proceed with other parser. That is the meaning. That is why we are discussing this one. So next, LR parser, also called as canonical LR. That's what I said. This is the new word you will be seeing everywhere. You will be seen here. So nothing to worry, that canonical, it's a kind of computation. We are going to look at into the problem. All the 4 types of problem, canonical set computation is mandatory. So that naturally you will come to know what it is, you will understand. So works on complete set of LR grammar. Notice the point. The power is increased. generates larger table and larger. Normally, the number of states are more, table will become larger. Since it is larger, it will be slower in construction or in computation. That's all. So there is a drawback, there is an advantage. Since it accepts larger number of classes, we need to depend on this guy. For example, who knows more information or who has more knowledge, we will be depending on it. That is when we will approach them. Once if we know all the micro level elements, only then we will approach the highest intelligent person. So it is like that, slow construction. Next, LALR works on intermediate size. Neither it is too large nor it is too smaller. That is why we are moving for another parser. It works for intermediate size. Number of states are same as SLR only, but how? The tricky we will see during the problem solving. Intermediate size of grammar. Intermediate size of grammar is what? The number of grammar simulated by this type of parser is intermediate. Neither it is too small nor it is too large. So that is the meaning. Now, number of state is same as SLR. So it is smaller. Canonical LR, last one. Canonical collection of LR, built CLR parsing table. Every time we are doing parsing table only, it produces more number of states, but the table will become smaller. That is a trick. How it is going to be? Let us see. The table will become smaller. How it is all the same representations are combined. States are combined. Nothing to worry right now. Even these points I can discuss or consolidate after solving all the problems also. But this is how we need to start with. We can revisit. After solving problem, if I revisit, you can understand the beauty of each and every point. Now let us move on to YLR parser. Handle, the group of LR parser can handle larger class of CFG. That is a primary advantage. Non-backtracking. It is called non-backtracking. Shift reduce parsing method. Detect syntax errors as soon as they occur. How quick it can detect syntax error? That much quick it can detect syntax error. More languages than LLGram. That is what already we said. Larger class. It's a repetition point only. Whichever the phrase you want, you can use. That is why we are moving on to LR. That is a fact from the beginning I am explaining. Drawbacks of LR. We need constructing LR parser by hand will take lot of time. We need to go for automated parser generator. We need to write a code. Otherwise, it is very tedious job. When we are solving the problem, you will notice how much time it takes. Every parser construction, how much time it takes, you yourself will be able to understand. Next. If the grammar contains ambiguity, then it is difficult to parse. Only look at operator precedence parser only. I said it works well with ambiguity. Look at this focus. Never I said this for the type of LR parser. That is why we need to work on removing ambiguity as well. Or we need to make grammar to become unambiguous as well. Construction also very tedious or time consuming construction. So that is a drawback. But however, the computation, the purpose of compiler design is possible only with the support of LR parser than even LL parser. Now let us move on to new terminology to get into parsing or problem solving. There are two basic new terminologies. Now I am going to introduce handle and handle pruning. That is useful for most of the time when we are solving the problem. So that first let us start with the handle. It's a substring. Handle of a string is a substring that matches right side of the production and involves in the reduction process. Reverse of the rightmost derivation. Now we are going to do this handle identification with the example. I will show you handle. Then I will come back to the definition. Handle pruning is the process of discovering the handle for the reduction action is handle pruning. That's all. I will revisit the definition. Look at this is the given input string. See, write sentential form. Reverse order, we are going to look at handle formation, reducing action. This is the given CFG. Look at this CFG first. Concentrate on it for a while. There are three productions available in which are in the given CFG. S produces AA, BE. A produces ABC, RB. B produces D. Now, let us look into how the given input string or right sentential form. Right sentential form is always we will look at this right side of the given production. Then we will convert it into left side of the non-terminal. We will focus on right side of the given production. We will look into left side of the non-terminal. That is called right sentential form. How this right sentential form is reduced to the starting symbol is a point of discussion. We need to ultimately reduce to the start symbol. How we are doing? During that time only handle formation is useful. Handle formation. This entire process is called handle pruning. That's it. Now look at this is a given input string. Ultimately, you need to scan from the left hand side. Always input string is scanned from the left to right only. That is why LL, LR parser. L stands for scanning the input from left to right. Now scan the first symbol. None of the production available, the right sentential form is available, suitable for that A, suitable to reduce that small A. Nothing is available. What is the meaning is small A alone it should stand for. Nowhere small A alone available. Now let us move. We are looking at another symbol. That is called B. B is a symbol under consideration. Yes, now there is a possibility of forming the handle. This B forms a handle because this production on the right hand side has B. Now we can reduce this B by capital A. That is why in the second line it is reduced with capital A. Next we need to move with small b. Next we need to move with C. Then that B again we cannot replace. If we replace, there is no combination called AA available. So that we are moving on, then we are trying to form a handle. Capital ABC becomes a handle. When we can consider that symbol for the reduction? Whenever there is a production available. So every time that since B has the production, every time if we start reducing it, what will happen? Further, we cannot reach the start symbol. So we need to look at the appropriate combination so that ABC forms a handle. Then we are trying to reduce this ABC by capital A using this production. Then what will happen? Small a followed by capital A, then D, then followed by E. Now, D forms a handle, B produces B. There is a production. So now we are replacing small d by capital B. Now all together it forms a handle with S. Now we are reducing it to S. This is called handle pruning. The entire process of reducing the input string to the starting symbol is stands for handle pruning. The formation of handle is what? In order to reduce the given input string, when the handle is identified for the reduction, that is called handle. Now revisit. Handle of a string is a substring that matches the right hand side of the sum production and whose reduction to the non-terminal of, on the left hand side is a step along with the reverse of some rightmost derivation. This is happening reverse of some rightmost derivation. Now what is handle pruning? The process of discovering a handle and reducing it to the suitable left hand side is called handle pruning. Always a rightmost derivation in reverse order is termed as canonical reduction. rightmost derivation in the reverse order. See, look at, always we are considering this rightmost. Again, we are considering this rightmost. In the reverse order, we are doing it in the reverse order for the reduction process. That's all, these two definition. Already you know how to reduce given the input string to the start symbol. Already we have seen example. Now we are introducing to new terminology. That's it, nothing more new here. We already have seen during rightmost derivation, leftmost derivation, bottom up parser, top down parser, illustration through the parse tree construction. We have seen this, the same only we are continuing. Now let us move on to shift reduce parser introduction. LR parser, otherwise called shift reduce parser, that is what in the given grammar itself illustrated. Within the category called shift reduce parser only, we are having this all four: SLR, LR, LALR, or canonical LR. These all four parser. So that we need to understand what is shift reduce parser. There are two actions will happen: shift reduce. What is the meaning of shift and reduce? Is almost is equivalent to stack operation, push and pop. Shift means push, reduce means pop. That way also you can understand. But here they are using this terminology, shift reduce parser. Now let us look into shift reduce parser. Shift reduce parser is a process reducing a string to the start symbol of the grammar. Just now we have seen this is reduced to the start symbol of the grammar. The same process what we are doing is called shift reduce parser. Uses the stack to hold the grammar. Always we use stack in the shift reduce parser. And input tape. Input tape or input buffer. Last time we have seen it as input buffer. You can consider this as input buffer itself. No need to change tape all of a sudden. I will rewrite it into buffer. That's it. Now, diagrammatic representation. Given the input string, our objective is to reduce to the start symbol. That is the purpose of shift reduce parser. Shift reduce parsing performs the two actions. One is shift, another one is reduce. That is why it is known as shift reduce parser. Shift action and reduce action. Next, shift action, as I mentioned, the current symbol in the input string is push to the stack. Look at, I said now shift is equal to push. Reduce action, the symbols will be replaced by non-terminals, or else we can say it as pop action as well. As the symbol is the right side of the production, non-terminal is the left side of the production. As I mentioned in the previous, look at, symbol is right side of the production, reduction is left side of the production. We are replacing small b by capital E. That is what here also we are looking at. Now let us look into the first problem, simple shift reduce parser. Very very simple, elegant way. Now slowly we are bringing the concept called shift reduce parsing through this simple example. Consider the CFG. S produces S plus C. Normally we used to give the same grammar E plus C. Same only here, the term non-terminals are different. This is for operator grammar. Operator precedence or operator grammar. S produces S minus S. S produces parenthesized S. S produces ID. This stands for ID. Instead of ID, we are giving A. One terminal symbol itself we are giving. Normally that is for identifier. Any expression you consider, name it arithmetic expression, logical expression, without identifiers or without operands, you cannot think of forming the expression. It is like that. So that A. Given the input string, you can end with dollar. That is an indicator for end of the string. I forgot to put, you can end with dollar. A1 stands for one of the variable, A2 stands for another variable, A3 stands for yet another variable. you are trying to do the evaluation A1 minus bracketed A2 plus A3. That's it. Now, how the shift reduce parsing happens? How this entire input string is going to be reduced to yes? Look at here. Yes, finally, this input is reduced to yes. That is what we are trying to look at now. How it is looks at, how we can compute it. It has three different components. One is stack content, another one is input string, another one is actions. So these three you should consider. Now we need to consider the input string. We need to consider the symbol A1 at a time, one symbol at a time. Don't look at A and 1. It is not like that. You should not look at A and 1. It is all together one of the terminal. You need to consider completely A1. Now, A1, you need to shift. You need to push it onto the stack. Now, $A1, immediately what you can do, you need to match with the production. It is matched with the fourth production. Then you can think of reducing. Reduce this A1 by S. Now it is replaced. The content, stack content, is replaced with S. Now you look at minus. There is no production matches with minus. You need to shift, push it onto the stack. Then look at open bracket. No production matches with only. There is no formation of handle. Not possible to form the handle. So that push it onto the stack. So S minus open bracket, you are pushing it onto the stack. A2, shift A2. A2 is pushed onto the stack, but the top of the stack symbol forms the handle, so we can reduce. A2 is reduced by S2. Then plus. Plus alone will not form the handle. Shift it onto the stack. So S plus. Look into A3. A3 also a terminal. Push it onto the stack, but look at it forms the handle, so that we are reducing this A3 by S. So yes. Look at close bracket. It is a terminal. Shift onto the stack. Now look at topmost content of the stack. Open bracket S plus S forms a handle. S plus S is formed by this first production. Look at here. S plus S. So that S plus S is replaced or reduced by S. Finally, open bracket or bracketed S formed by production number 3, so that you are replacing by S. Finally, S minus S is formed by the production number 2, so you are replacing by S. Now you can accept, because given input string is reduced to S. Input buffer is having dollar. Stack content is having dollar. That is not our botheration or issue. So now we can move with accepting stage. With that note, I'm completing this shift reduce parsing action. If you have any doubt, you can clarify. If you have any doubt, you can clarify right now. 1 minute. Someone is waiting on the lobby, but I am not able to see. I don't know what to do. Come on, guys, if you have any doubts on that shift reduce parsing. So far, no, whatever you know, your prior knowledge is more than sufficient to proceed with shift reduce parser, as well as learning handle and handle pruning. That comparative study of all the four parser, we no need to worry right now. Definitely, we can consider later on. I think C4 raised hand. That is why I'm notified. If you have anything, you can unmute yourself. You can talk to me, or you can use the chat box for the communication. Guys, do you have any doubts on so far now what is discussed? Shift reduce parser or the foundation, LR of K, if you understand, more than enough. L stands for left to right scanning of the input string. R stands for reverse of the rightmost revision. K stands for number of look ahead symbol. That is more than enough. Then majorly it is categorized into two type bottom up parser. One is operator precedence parser, another one is shift reduce parser. Operator precedence parser will work well with the ambiguous grammar, whereas shift reduce parser will not work. Shift reduce parser, just now we introduced pushing some symbol onto the stack and finding or forming the handle and reducing. So, sequence of reduction action taking place. Given the input string is finally targeted to reduce to start symbol. That is what our core purpose, nothing more we are doing. Then subsequently, shift reduce parser categorized into four. That four parts you need to remember. Then every parser, we will be computing canonical set. Then we will be forming the table. The table consists of go to and action table. That's it. Then parsing algorithm, parsing action. During the parsing action, stack plays a major role. These are all the points you may need to keep in mind. Now we are moving on to operator precedence parser. Just today I introduced. Tomorrow we can, or next class we can dive into deeper into operator precedence parser. Subsequently we are moving on to all the types of shift reduce parser. Now the moment you name it operator precedence parser, that name itself says it's meant for fixing the precedence for the operators. It is meant for only the operator. That we need to remember or keep in mind all the time. Look at. Used to define mathematical operators is called. It is meant for only mathematical operators. It's used to define only the mathematical operator. Operator precedence parser will not be useful for any other context except the precedence setting. Only for the precedence setting, among set of operators, this grammar is used or useful. Otherwise, it is called operator grammar. It is a CFG only. The moment E produces E plus E, that is the classic example for operator grammar. E produces, just now we have seen, S produces S plus S, S minus S, S produces bracketed S, S produces ID. So that example is classical example for operator grammar or operator precedence grammar. Such grammar have the restriction that, note this point, we are going to look into, illustrate through problems. I am going to illustrate these two points. The moment you say operator precedence grammar, it should not have epsilon on the right hand side. Empty never it should become. Empty is otherwise called what? Epsilon. In the given grammar, never ever the grammar should have epsilon. That is a primary condition. Number two, it two adjacent non-terminals should not be available on the right hand side. Capital S followed by capital A. Something like that should not be available. That is a secondary condition of operator precedence grammar. Now we are going to look at, given the grammar, whether that is operator precedence grammar or not. That verification we are going to look at subsequently. Remember, no epsilon should be available. No two adjacent non-terminals should sit on the right-hand side. Remember carefully. Now, look at the first CFG. It has two production. Both of the production doesn't have empty or epsilon. We are lucky. First rule is applied. Look at second rule. Two adjacent non-terminals are not permitted. Look at three non-terminals are sitting together. Capital E, capital A, capital E. Will it be permitted? Say yes or no. Is it operator precedence grammar or not? That's it. Yes or no, you say. There are two rules, I said. that both of the rules need to be followed, obeyed for the operator precedence grammar. First rule, I myself said there is no epsilon, so it is operator precedence grammar with respect to rule number one. Now, with respect to rule number two, tell me whether it is operator precedence grammar or not. Yes or no? Come on, guys. No. Excellent. That's all. It is not a operator precedence grammar because two non-terminal they are telling, but we have three non-terminals. Definitely not. But there is a possibility of converting this grammar to become eligible for operator precedence grammar. How? That is what we are going to look at. See, there are two operators for A, plus and star. Replace, substitute, throw this grammar, then it will become operator precedence. This grammar is no, not a operator precedence. Why? Because adjacent non-terminals are available. Yes, this is, it is not an operator precedence grammar. It is operator precedence grammar. It is not a operator precedence grammar. It is a precedence grammar, operator precedence. Look at the second one. Now tell me, is it operator precedence grammar or not? Apply both of the rule. Right hand side should not become empty or epsilon, or no adjacent non-terminal should be available. This grammar is operator precedence grammar or not? Yes or no question? Come on, guys. There are two rules. Very simple. Look at both the rule and tell me yes or no. This grammar, it is not a operator precedence grammar. I'll tell you. Okay, see, this grammar doesn't have epsilon, no empty, this is fulfilled. Look at the second rule, two adjacent non-terminals in its right hand side. Non-terminals are three, there are three non-terminals adjacent sitting together, so that it is not a operator precedence grammar. It is not a operator precedence grammar. That is fine. Then how can we convert it into operator precedence grammar is the next point of discussion. Not a operator precedence grammar. Look at the same grammar we are trying to convert it into operator precedence. Replace, substitute this capital A by BSB, subsequently by this B. Now this A is replaced by capital S, BSB, yes. Replaced by BSB. A is replaced by BSB. Second one is what? SB, yes. Replaced by another production, SBS. This one, this B replaced SBS. Given A, now it is not recovered because everything is substituted. Now we have converted the given CFG to become operator precedence. Now it is yes, because look at, no epsilon is available, no adjacent symbols or non-terminal. Every non-terminal is separated by one terminal, small b. Another two non-terminals are separated by small b. Here also there are two non-terminals S and S separated by small b. And this is only one terminal, we don't have any problem. Could you get that? I'll just display all the four grammar together. Try to understand how I am telling this is not a operator precedence grammar and this is operator precedence grammar. Although the power are same, see, the power of computation for these two are same. Manually if you do, the power of computation, manually if you do, the power of computation are same. But as per operator precedence convention, it is not permitted. Have a glance for a while, understand. If you have doubt, you can have discussion with me. Simple, two rules, no epsilon. There are two grammar only I have brought. That is converted grammar, rest of two are converted grammar. Among those two grammar, none of the grammar has epsilon on the right hand side. First rule is fulfilled. When it comes to second rule, what is the emphasis? No two non-terminals should sit together. Two only they are telling, but in all the grammar, whatever I have taken example, three non-terminals are sitting together. Definitely not permitted. Hope so you would be understanding now. See, three non-terminals are sitting together. But the same grammar I have converted to become operator precedence after this replacement, substitution. Similarly, the same grammar I have brought it into operator precedence grammar by the substitution. This A is replaced by this. Similarly, this A is replaced by another alternative B. Then this original A, that's all. Now these two are operator precedence grammar. These two are operator precedence grammar because look at the condition. No epsilon, no two non-terminals are sitting beside, adjacent, one by one. That is why it is operator precedence. Look at ambiguous grammars are not allowed in any parser except, that is a beauty. This already we have seen. It is redundant topic. This one, what is the power of operator precedence grammar is, it permits ambiguity, ambiguous grammar. That's it. Now, let us look into the very first step of understanding operator precedence grammar. We are going to introduce three relational operators. Look at, not like a conventional relational operator. It is augmented with dots, less than dot, equal to dot, dot greater than, or greater than dot. So that is a new meaning we are bringing for that operator. That is why it is given. We can use any type of symbol, but all the textbooks conventionally uses this kind of symbol, so that we need to adhere. Now using these symbols only, we are going to define the priority, precedence of the operator. That is what. So look at the first rule. A less than dot B. This means A yields precedence to B. That means B has highest precedence. That's all. In simple term, understand, B has highest precedence than A. What is the meaning? Any operator it could be. A, B stands for any operator. That's all. B has highest precedence than A or over A. A, B has highest precedence over A. Next is what? A greater than B. This means A takes precedence over B. The same only I'm going to make it ulta. Now A has highest precedence than B. Now equal to has same precedence. A and B are, whichever the way articulation you prefer, you can use it. That's it. Now, how we need to, these are all the simple three rules we need to remember in order to proceed with operator precedence parsing. So now, both end of given input add the dollar symbol. Input string, normally I used to discuss input symbol dollar is added only at one end. End of the grammar input string only we used to add dollar. Now what the emphasis is, you need to add both end of the input string. That is a new rule we are looking at. Both end of the given input string add dollar symbol. Scan the input string from left to right until greater than is encountered. That is the rule. Remember, left to right we need to scan. Input string we need to go as usual. Left to right only we used to scan until this is found. Now how it is going to be found, let us see. Then we need to go into reduction action. Everything between leftmost less than symbol and greater than symbol forms a handle. Now easily handle formation is possible. Scan towards left over all the equal precedence until the first leftmost is encountered. You may feel difficulty in understanding, nothing to worry. Finally, dollar dollar if you are having, then it is called successful action. That's all. That is algorithm. I'll explain through with example. Look at this grammar. E produces E plus T or T. T produces T star F or F. F produces ID. This is a given input string. ID plus ID star ID. How you can reduce to E? Through parse tree. ID is replaced, reduced by F. ID is reduced by F. ID is reduced by F. Then this expression F star ID, T star F is reduced, T star F. This level you need to look at. T star F is reduced by T. Similarly, ID is reduced by F. F is reduced by T. T is reduced by E. E plus T is reduced by E. This is how it reduction happens. Next, we need to proceed with parse table construction. This is the highest part of learning. This parse table construction, if you look at less than, equal to, greater than, look at, greater than. All the three symbols are available. Equal to, greater than, less than. So using this parse table only, it is possible to do the parsing action. Given the input ID plus ID star ID, how the parsing action is happening? Dollar dollar. When it becomes dollar dollar, then with the start symbol. This is also a handle. Then no more parsing is possible, so that we are accepting. Now itself 10:46. With that note, let me complete. Again tomorrow, let me revisit from here. Where is that parsing action onwards? Or this example. Let us walk through this example from the beginning, from the next class onwards. With that note, if you have doubt, you can